right. all that other stuff. This is rewriting the code of your baby.
Oh, so, I don't like that.
So when it's born, well, see, that's the thing though, because then maybe they can spot. I'm talking way out of my depth over here. Right.
I really need to read up on this.
Yeah.
This is just like Gattaca.
But essentially, I think what it is that they, like, if they're given the opportunity to be able to spot, like, let's say, Down syndrome or something along those lines, and then kind of like figure out what needs to change for them to be able to rectify that.
Jeez.
It's interesting.
It's a slippery slope, man.
I don't think it's legal to do it on humans in the United States.
You know they're doing it on a ship off the coast of like Australia or some crap.
I'm pretty sure China does it pretty like freely.
Jeez. They're making like a wolfman.
Yeah.
For their army.
This is the first time in like many episodes where I'm like, I don't know, Jack, all of this could be wrong, but I know CRISPR does that.
I'm just hoping they can make like a wolfman or something. Can you imagine how fun that would be?
It would.
He'd be like Scooby-Doo for real. Like,
no. It's got to be. They, you see, the thing is that I love fiction so much that I want it so that if they're like, okay, so we spliced a human with a wolf
right.
so that he could hunt better because he's an avid hunter.
Right.
And then it goes wrong. And then the hunter becomes the hunter.
I don't understand what just happened.
I was about to say,
the wolf bit itself?
In my brain, I'm like, the hunter becomes the hunter or something. Like, but no.
I think all of that is just one. The problem with all of this is that, you know, you'd be like trying to get tall kids with like,
yeah,
they were smart. I think not being perfect adds so much character to people because all of your friends, like all of my friends are people striving for happiness, but they're totally imperfect.
Yeah.
Not one person. If I had one person who was just like banging all cylinders, I was like, I'm not going to be around you.
It's just a constant reminder of how imperfect
you are. But I don't know a single person like that. I've never come across a person that is, you know.
Well, it's not only the fact that they're perfect. It's your perception of what is perfect as well.
That's how I view the world.
You're never going to be able to do it, my friend.
No.
There's nothing as perfect. There's nothing perfect. Except God, I don't know. Just,
all right.
You know.
Alhamdulillah.
Dude, can we first talk about the stupidness of UFC 209 just real quick?
I don't. All right, we'll talk about
it. Just
here's the thing.
I need to vent a little
on
bit.
On the way here, I was trying to listen to a podcast that was like react. You, Sure Dog did it. Jordan Breen, Reaction 209. It's 30 minutes in, they aren't even talking about it. Because he's just like, let's just talk about some other stuff. It was very frustrating.
He's not beat down after the bell, is it?
No, it's like he wasn't on beat down. Some other fighter was. So Jordan decided to do it yesterday. Biggie Small's birthday. That's what he talked about for the first 20 minutes. It's Biggie Smalls. But I had the same reaction, man. That was rough. That was rough from start to finish of that fight.
It's funny because 209 was slated to be like one of the better cards.
Yeah.
You know? Well, they had to do something better from after that Holly Holm Jermaine fiasco. Okay, maybe not a fiasco, but come on now. First of all, Khabib.
Can't make weight.
Can't make weight.
I don't like it.
That is not good.
I'm mad.
That is a problem. And the thing is that I feel like, I mean, everyone's talked about this. Everyone's got an opinion on it. And we I don't know where I stand on it, but UFC seems to be losing a lot of fights or losing a lot of money as a result simply because of this weight cut issue. So if they could approach it in a different manner, it would be really cool. Because you know what? There's a lot of fighters that we know that no longer cut weight. And we get better fights out of them.
I think so. I think there's less chance someone's going to be injured, less chance they're going to be depleted during the fights themselves are better.
Yeah.
But
Kevin Gastelum was amazing in that Tim Kennedy fight.
Yeah, he didn't cut weight. He didn't make weight for that, did he?
No. That's a weight class above his.
Oh.
So the fight before, Kevin Gastelum didn't make weight. Everyone gets pissed. And then Dana gives him the fight with Tim Kennedy.
Yeah.
Tim Kennedy is one full weight class above Kevin.
Right.
But Kevin came in there and boxed his ass off.
Here's the problem. So let's say you're fighting at, well, you know what? Let's say I'm fighting at 155 because I'm closer to there. No, I'm like closer to friggin' tiny people division. Anyways, the divisions are so far apart.
Yeah.
Khabib fights at 155. Guess what he walks around at? Take a guess.
Probably closer to 170.
Exactly. Probably are at 170.
Yeah.
Meaning that if he actually goes up to the 170 division, he should technically be around like 185, 190, because he can't hang with the 170s.
Mm-hmm.
So what choice does he have?
More weight classes.
That You know what? You got to have... Yeah, maybe. I don't know fans like that. If I ask you right now to name all the...
Can't do it.
No, can't do it.
Can't do it.
But I also feel like the more champions, the better, because you can like... People will tune in for at least a belt. Yeah. At least have one or two more, man.
Mm-hmm. There's got to be like maybe not at the fringes, mm-hmm. but like in the concentrated middle.
Mm, I feel bad for Tony though.
Ferguson?
Yo, the guy trained his like he trained his butt off. He was Instagramming like crazy.
Yeah, he was putting in work in all cylinders. Okay, I felt bad.
Yeah.
But I think Tony did. Tony was classy.
I don't give two craps about that. I don't know why people care what somebody says, how nice they are or how mean they are. I don't appreciate it all. I get mad when people say, oh, this is classy. I'm like, what do you want him to say?
What else could he said? Just bitch, like talk shit again.
Either way, like none of it matters.
Conor McGregor would have.
He that's should right. talk shit.
You'll do nothing. No, you'll do nothing.
Khabib should do his job and make weight.
Yeah, that's true.
Get better. You didn't make weight.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like you got friggin'.
So it wasn't kidney stones?
That's just what happens when you're dehydrating yourself right. and not drinking a lot of water. Yeah. You're gonna get kidney stones.
You know what though?
What?
Here's the thing.
Huh?
In the deep recesses of my gut, I felt like Tony might have won that fight.
Yeah, could have happened, man.
Yeah.
Now we don't know. This fight's been rescheduled 3 times now.
That must be annoying. You can't like it's hard. As a professional,
mm-hmm.
you have to make that weight.
Yeah.
Because there's so much riding on it.
Oh, yeah.
And you can't talk crap.
Yeah.
If you can't even make it to the ring.
Right.
That's
absolutely like, true.
At the very least, make it to the ring and like he was hospitalized, you see. Or he went to the hospital.
He went to the hospital.
Whatever you want to say, the thing is that it's not like he could like at the very least he could have took the pay cut and then show up and at least put out a performance. But they couldn't do that either, right? So, very disappointing, but whatever. Hopefully Khabib comes back, figures out how to weight cut properly.
I'm rooting for Tony.
It's funny because, you know.
I have no problem rooting for non-Muslims.
Now I'm totally. You know what's funny?
Yeah.
Tony Ferguson did actually say, good luck on that weight cut, bro.
He said that
during the face-offs or whatever.
Dude, that guy lost like so much money. Tony Ferguson lost so much money.
Yeah, that sucks.
They don't give you half. I thought they give you half.
Mm.
Like for showing up.
Yeah.
Tony Ferguson, I think, is on a 200K and 200K contract.
Mm-hmm.
You get 200K for making weight, 200K for having the fight.
Yeah.
Since there was no fight, according to him, they gave him less than like the show money. So he said it barely covered his training expenses.
Oh man!
So now he's just like, man, I hope I get another fight lined up.
Yeah.
And he hopes he wins it because you can't go this long without money coming in. Probably,
Yeah. And you put in all that work. It's so much. It's heartbreaking. I remember seeing DC.
Mm-hmm.
Where they had the behind the scenes camera.
Yeah.
When
When
Dana goes up to DC and tells him that Jones dropped out.
Yeah.
Because he got popped.
Oh, he was devastated.
Holy.
That guy was about to. Did he cry? He was about. Like, looked
I think
like
he was very close to crying. Yeah. You know, speaking about crying.
Yeah.
Watching that Wonder Boy Woodley fight.
That was, speaking of sleeping, like, honestly, that was the most frustrating. This is a perfect example that if you're going to show a new person MMA, this is what not to show.
Yeah.
You're like, this is a championship fight, especially when people are jacked.
Yeah.
Like, Woodley looks like a freaking...
You can't look like Woodley and fight that fight.
You can't look like that and fight like that.
No.
No. Because I'm like, what are you afraid of? You're freaking immortal. You know? Like, you can run through...
It was no good either, like because what they were saying was the fact that both of them were so good that it negated their game plan.
Bullshit.
Exactly.
Sorry, I've seen many people fight. I've seen many humans fight.
Start throwing bones.
Yeah, just start throwing hands. Good things will happen. You've been training. It was a 4.5 minute long feeling out period. The last 20 seconds were exciting, and nobody was satisfied with the outcome. Yeah. Nobody.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Tyron can say what he wants about, like, not getting respect because of his race and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But you fight like that, nobody likes you. Nobody white, nobody black, Eskimos,
no Syeds, one. No one's going to freaking listen to you,
your
man.
Your mom's going to be like...
That's it. No.
Not me.
For some reason, I kind of... Because I love DC.
Mm-hmm.
I love him.
Okay.
He's the greatest guy ever.
Aww.
I don't know. I haven't met him, but I assume
he's
great.
No, but he seems like a stand-up dude.
He's so great.
He's like a father.
Right? And it really hurts me when he gets booed. So I'm hoping people just start booing Woodley and then just lay off of DC. Let DC get
people
some
don't
cheers.
Have a finite amount of racial booze. They're like, well, we're already booing this black dude. We can't do. People will.
Do you think they're both black. I thought they normally they boo him just because he does the iron blanket.
Who?
DC.
DC? Well, they both do the iron. Here, listen.
No.
There's Woodley, a French Woodley. Canadian blanket out there that people bought pay per views for years, right?
Yeah.
George St. Pierre. It's not the fact that he's a tremendous exciting fighter like Anderson. Yeah. It's just that like nobody could solve that puzzle,
yeah.
And you always tuned in to see like to put another killer and another killer. And GSP will get in your guard and elbow you until the cows come home, but he doesn't take a lot of risks. You can still watch it.
It's so funny. It's just, it was that fight with the jab that we were talking about, where it's just the whole fight.
Yep.
Ka-donk.
Just like somebody had Ka-donk. That, like they found the one button on the controller. You're like, I know this is punch. It's just like punch, punch, punch. DC gets booed because MMA fans like to see like a super macho character.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can do anything and I will run. You know, they want that Conor McGregor.
Yeah.
Even if when we know
DC's
it's fake.
Not that.
Yeah, DC's like, I'm going to beat you because I'm better, and he'll talk technically. And it's like, boring.
I'm trying to feed my family.
Yeah.
That type of, but I love him.
But
I love
on the other side, you have a coke snorting, pregnant lady hitting, car crashing, fence jumping dude that people are like, yeah, that's the guy you want. That's the guy from Troy who had the point of the army.
Oh,
it's not DC.
I hate
He's farming at home.
I want that rematch so bad. I want the John Jones with DC rematch.
That's the problem, man. Timing is everything.
Yeah.
Because I still think DC is in its prime, but like back in the day, that was like the right time.
Yeah.
Both guys were, you know, at their peaks.
Yeah,
now,
that's true.
The UFC is different. But with that said, I'll watch Woodley fight whoever, and I hope he loses.
Yeah.
I was hoping Wonderboy would beat him so he'd be more exciting champion.
Too. Well, I felt like Wonderboy won that fight. In my very limited knowledge of fighting, it felt like at least three rounds went to him.
I went 1-2 for Wonder Boy.
Yeah.
And it was like, if anybody watches these fights, it's just so close because they're barely touching each other. Like, straight up, it's tag, right? It's like, oh, shit, he touched me. First two, I gave to Homeboy, Wonder Boy. Yeah. Second one, third one, I definitely gave to Woodley because of the takedown.
Yeah.
And then what happened was that the fourth one, I believe, was Woodley. And the split was some judges thought it was Wonder Boy. And the last one went 10-8 to Woodley.
To Woodley.
Which because there's no offense. The I could be element. Wrong about the placement at all of those, but like it was so close that it wasn't even fun. Like there's no point of breaking it down. It's just like,
that's it.
There's such a thing in respecting your opponent and figuring out what their range is at the beginning. When this guy throws a jab, it gets this far.
Mm-hmm.
When I do this, he reacts this way, and then you're just lining it up, right? Anderson was great at this. First 2 minutes, just moving in and out, figuring out this person's range, speed, see what they're working with.
And then once you got this front kick to the jaw.
Right. And you saw it coming, where all of a sudden he just got loose. He started dancing. And then he just started raining on you. But with this, it was just like, it's like 3.5 minutes in, or just like looking at each other.
Yeah.
Like, oh no, they're not going to hit each other. The crowd starts screaming, fight, fight, fight. Like it's a high school. Start laughing.
It's funny because both corners were saying, all right, we need you to, literally, we need you to try to fight more.
Yep. Both sides.
Oh man.
That was ridiculous. Abomination.
Yeah, no, it wasn't so great. It wasn't so great at all.
Welcome to MMA, man. Yeah. Every now and then that happens.
Oh, it's
that
fine.
Was one of the worst though. That was one of the worst that I've seen.
I think I was reading some articles. They were naming it as the most disappointing title fight ever.
I would say it's between that and Anderson Silva versus Damian Maya.
Okay, I never explain.
So Anderson Silva has a grudge against Damian Maya.
Really? Damian Maya is so nice.
Apparently the nicest guy ever. But Damian Maya is also, guess what? White, kinda.
Okay.
Like he's from the upper class.
Of Brazil.
While Anderson is from the lower class.
Right.
And while, like, there was a time when Damian fell on his back, like, you know, just to see if Anderson would come at his guard, Anderson's just like cursing at him in Portuguese and calling him like pretty boy and fancy boy, like his translations and stuff up. And he would, instead of actually finishing him, he would like try to like dance all around him to make him look stupid because he was apparently mad at him. Which Damien was like, I don't know. I do jujitsu. But yeah. And it was boring and it went to a decision. While at that point, Anderson was like the king of the middleweight division. Yeah. The UFC had gone to Abu Dhabi to put this fight on. The Prince of Abu Dhabi had bought 10% of the UFC. Mm. It was in Ferrari land.
Yeah.
They built a stadium to like a whole thing for this.
Yeah.
And all the buildup was amazing. And then it was a lot of like Anderson just clowning all around him.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the only knock on Anderson, is like when he felt like he didn't have to fight up to a certain standard, he sometimes didn't.
Yeah.
But with that like laundry list of kills that he has, you can do that every now and then. And Woodley doesn't have that reputation. Like,
no, you don't get to
He's done that a really good fights a few times, but historically he's a blanket. So mm-hmm. we'll see what happens, man. The UFC needs some stars. Just saying, let people use steroids. I have no problem with it.
No, if they do that, it's got to be like an age thing. Certainly.
Why, you want to see old people die? Like,
no. Once when you get older, that's when you're able to get your steroids in.
Hmm.
Right? 35? Once you hit 35, you start.
Whenever your blood levels drop.
Yeah, whatever it is.
Shit. I'll do it. I'm looking forward to it, man. A couple of more years. I mean, when I get to 38.
Right.
Yeah.
Just going to be lifting like a monster.
Oh, my God. Anything. I'd be lifting like random things walking around Toronto.
You've been up on your workouts these days, man? I've been horrible last couple weeks.
I've been there's a guy at my new job. Yeah. He does Krav Maga. Big okay. black dude. Does right. Krav Maga.
Uh-huh.
Terrible combination. Because he doesn't have any in Krav Maga, you don't it's all practical based.
Yeah.
Eye gouging is allowed. So he's like has no gas tank, but it's like you can't spar with the guy
because
mm-hmm. he's just like trying to kill you.
Yeah.
Which is a problem, but he like gave me a really good workout. So mm-hmm. I've been kind of, and it's just a lot of like push up combined with squats, combined with burpees, combined with like crunches.
His body squats?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All this body weight stuff. Mm-hmm. And with 2 minute rest in between.
Yeah.
I can't like lift a lot, mm-hmm. but I jumped through my mom's car window and landed on the seats. I rolled the window down and if I was standing beside it. I put one hand on top of the car, my right hand, jumped in. I can jump a lot higher. I just feel physically a lot more athletic. So, feels good.
So, when you see a car...
Yeah?
When you see your mom's car with the right. windows down...
Yeah.
And you're like, you're going to Dukes of Hazzard this shit.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And jump in.
Yeah.
This is...
It occurs... These things occur to me. I walk around Toronto wondering if I can jump from that area to that area. And I do it.
Okay.
It's fun.
All right.
Here,
I think that's why that's how you hurt yourself a lot.
I've hurt myself playing sports where I push myself because I can't let somebody else impose their will on me.
Yeah.
Even though they don't care that much.
Uh-huh.
But I care a lot. This kind of stuff it's not going to hurt that man.
Fair enough.
That's how you feel young, man.
There is a video online.
You know how much younger you feel as soon as you jump into a car with the window down?
I think my dad told a story like that.
See?
About him jumping in cars.
What are you looking up?
There's a video of a Jamaican stepping into a car. While holding like a case of beers or something.
I don't even know what that means. Of course a Jamaican would step into it. Is he drinking? Is it a drunk driving video?
No. Steps into car.
Are you Googling Jamaican steps into car?
Yes.
Man, you're going to come across a lot of videos of Jamaican people just walking into cars.
You know what? It might not be a Jamaican.
Maybe you just thought that guy looked Jamaican.
Kinda. Now I'm gonna go through the various races and see if I can.
What's
your
second? You're like Dominican man, Guyanese dude.
I don't know.
What's a person?
I might have to let this one go.
You can.
Yeah.
Unless you think it's worth it.
Yeah. Apparently, it's one of those. You know what? It's one of those videos back in the day when E-bombs world was a thing.
Yeah, I remember that little while.
Yeah.
There was a lot of aggregators back in the day.
Yeah.
Or you just
Break.com.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just you go on there and you waste like hours, you know?
It was so good.
We still have that. But
university.
Like not like the way it used to be. Mm. World Star Hip Hop has a lot of that where you could just like watch people fight for like an hour.
Yeah. The best ones of those videos.
Yeah.
It's when it starts off and it's a guy bullying a guy.
Oh yeah.
And like, and his kid looks like,
satisfying.
And the kid looks like he's been bullied for a while.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden,
yep, he's had enough.
Yeah.
He's had it. Have you seen the? It's in the cafeteria.
Oh, great! One of the greatest videos ever. This kid's because of bullied? His prep. Yeah. Because of
he
his prep.
He takes his pants down. He has shorts on under. Double leg takedown. Two shots to the face. Gets up. Walks away. One of the. He takes his pants down. Can you imagine when everybody would tell like the next day, Jose, he got in a fight with Jonathan. Jose took his pants down. He had shorts on under. He's been training. Double leg. Two shots in the head. Woodley could have learned a thing.
Yes.
Straight up. And the people are, bullies are always, first of they're either assholes or sometimes they're not even bigger. I don't know where it comes, like, mm-hmm. Have you seen the skinny kid who's bullying this fat kid and the fat guy just picks him up and just drops him? Yes. Yes.
Like, he gets dropped so hard that he bounced off the ground.
And he started limping. He fell. He got smashed so hard on the floor. He started limping, and I was just like, "Why were you punching a guy three times your size?"
I need to see the video.
You need to see the video. But that's like a raccoon, man. Some kids, I don't know what it is in their head that makes them think they can bully somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I think it makes them feel better. Like, how can hitting somebody make you feel better? Is a certain mindset, right? Mm-hmm. For normal people.
Yeah.
But this kid is just like steadily just poking this giant dude until the guy does what? Just picks him up and body slams, like WWE, but better. Way better.
There's too many videos. I'm gonna find it. Oh, there it is. 43 seconds of wonder. Here we go. There we go. I'm just gonna hold it this way.
Oh my God. It's like a, oh, he hit him in the mouth. Yeah. I'd be so proud of that guy if he was my son, by the way, for body slamming him. Yeah. Look, he's bouncing around this little. Here. Oh! Oh my.
Oh!
Jeez. Oh my God. It's on. And his son just walks away. Yeah, nobody else wants a piece of that. Look at this.
He's into the camera.
Well deserved.
Those are my favorite videos.
You ever have any experience getting attacked by a raccoon, or a raccoon just starts stepping on you?
No, I've been attacked by a Canada goose, but you first.
I don't have a story.
What? I felt like you were stepping.
Of course, I have a raccoon story. I wasn't going to talk about it, but I'm just saying, like, I feel like, you know. Idiot kid likes that, yeah. Has a predatory instinct.
Okay.
Or just something about him that makes him feel better from like dominating somebody.
Yeah, he might be bullied at home.
I don't give no excuses. I don't give any excuses to anybody.
He's
I understand.
A kid though, right?
I know.
Okay.
So that's why I'm like, I fully understand that.
I'm not saying he shouldn't get body slammed. I'm just merely saying that.
I think we both agree he should get body
yeah,
slammed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just in case. It's, you know, somebody's recording, it's highly entertaining. Yeah. Just for my own pleasure, yeah, he should get body slammed.
Yeah.
If you hit somebody, that's what I want to see happen. But like, when it comes to animals that are much smaller, they have that same thing where they're like, a raccoon, my story was that I went camping,
mm-hmm.
about 30 people. Mm-hmm. We got two awesome sites,
mm-hmm.
girl side here, guy side here.
Oh, so Muslim?
Oh, so Muslim, right?
Yeah.
It was great.
Mm-hmm.
Girl side did not pack away their food when they were going to bed.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we both all ate at the same area. We're just like, girl, can you clean this up? We're going over here. I'm not saying it's right, but
that's what happened.
The kitchen was over there.
Right.
I don't know why.
Brown things.
Right. So in the middle of the night, 2 a.m., you hear like rustling outside.
Yeah.
And you know it's pitch black and people aren't really walking outside. Mm-hmm. There's no, you can't see flashlights. I opened the thing. And I'm like, oh man, there's noise out here and there are no lights. So mm-hmm. that's no good. Either somebody's trying to get into our car
mm-hmm.
or something like that. So mm-hmm. I'm like, I wake up a couple of our friends, Rafi, Hamid.
Mm-hmm.
I go, like, we get our flashlights out. There's about, actually, it's not even like a number. It's like a family of raccoons. Mm-hmm. There's like a mama, a papa, two kids. And they are going to town and all of our trash. Mm-hmm. And they've got like the cooler open.
Yeah.
They open the cooler. Yeah. These guys have thumbs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They have thumbs. So we turn our light on them, right? They look at us. Mm-hmm. And they're like, yeah. And then it, like, the leader starts walking towards me.
First of all, lights flash in their face. They look at you and they're like, what are you going to
do? Yeah. And you know what? I was like, psst, get out of here. And I like step forward and he steps forward. And I was like, and I took a step backwards because I wasn't expecting that, you know, like.
It's like a raccoon is squaring up, dude. Yeah.
Things went like.
What do you know? Do you know Krav Maga?
Things went off track immediately because I'm not used to me getting close to an animal like, hey. And then he's like, what? And I was like, whoa. I thought I was bigger than you, obviously. Then I look around and like, does he have friends? Things I don't know. It's like a raptor situation. Yeah. Uh-huh. But they have no fear. They don't have fear the same way like. Other animals do, depending on size and stuff.
I think they don't have fear because they know humans.
I guess so.
They've already figured out humans are a bunch of bitches. But we're
messed up. We will throw a rock at you. Mm-hmm. Like, humans will mess with any animal, yeah. Especially if you're at our food. Mm-hmm. But this thing just... And as we started throwing up, like, rocks, and we weren't trying to hit them, but we throw it around them, they got the idea, and guess what they did? Mm-hmm. They tried to take the cooler and the bag into the woods. They were just... slowly, not even quickly, just as we're like, hey, get out of here, they're like, all right, let me wrap my you know,
and I'm gonna take this meal, yeah, to go.
Half the bag, they're just like three of them are just dragging the bag. The, yeah, cooler was too heavy. Mm-hmm. But the guy tried,
yeah,
you could see him with his thumbs try to take the cooler. It's like, okay, just Coke cans, dude. But then again, I'm like, do they know? Do they know how to open that?
Did I tell you the story about the raccoon that no. Okay, so I think I told the story before, whatever. When we do slow, like a crock pot, uh-huh, slow cook some lamb, mm-hmm, which by the way, my mom makes crazy good.
I believe
slow cooking lamb. But because it's gotta be like, the crock pot needs to be on for about like 6 hours or something. Jeez. Like 4 hours, just so you can get that nice, you know,
you ain't
soft
kidding thing about that slow cook.
So, my dad, what he, mm-hmm, does is that he runs an extension cord from inside, mm-hmm, and he plugs it outside in the side of the house.
Okay.
So it cooks outside and then our house doesn't smell like food for,
right,
long period of time.
Yeah.
Anyway, so you keep an eye on it every once in a while. And my dad, like near the end of it being like ready.
Yeah.
You know, my dad goes outside, check out on it.
Right.
There's a raccoon sitting on his butt.
Right.
In front of the crock pot with his one paw. He has the cover lifted as if he's like,
yeah,
taking a sniff.
I could even see the raccoon like holding a finger up to you like, it's not done yet.
You can go back inside.
Yeah, you can go back in.
No, I didn't get attacked by Canada goose. I got, I was feeding ducks. Mm-hmm. That's how it normally happens, right?
Right.
You're a, yeah, little kid.
Yep.
You got some
bread
trimmings, whatever, right, the crust is. There
the
we
crust,
go.
Yeah.
Right. You bread go over trimmings there with all your hopes and dreams, yep, to feed some ducks, mm, and then inevitably the Canada goose. They see that there's bread there.
Right.
And they're saying, we want some of this.
And they're assholes by, yeah, nature.
Yep.
Some animals are assholes by nature.
Yep.
And Canada goose is one of them.
So while I was feeding, I was holding some bread in my hands while, mm, I was trying to feed the ducks.
Right.
Trying to avoid the geese.
Yeah.
And the ducks weren't the geese weren't having any of that.
Yeah.
So they attacked me for the food that was in my hand.
No way. How old were you?
I was a kid.
Like, How old were you?
I don't remember. I'm gonna.
You gotta
go
give me
say,
a ballpark. I want to know if you're 8 or 16. You know, like.
right. I believe about grade four, grade five.
Okay.
That's when I realized.
Yeah.
That their tongues have like, yeah, spikes or barbs or something.
Yeah.
Because when he went for the thing, mm-hmm, there was a lot of spikiness that was happening.
Like it's trickly? Trying, like,
yeah.
That, oh really? I didn't know that.
That on the tongue and the side ridges of the of a geese.
Yeah, I thought that's all soft.
No, it's got like a thing.
Yeah, yeah, no. You won't be able to tell by a picture if it's soft. I know what it looks like though.
Yeah.
Because they hiss at you when they open their mouth.
Yeah.
And I once kicked one.
Okay.
Just in the face.
This is better.
Right.
Uh huh. Sometimes you gotta kick.
Oh no, that's not better, is
sometimes,
it?
Sometimes because you
then
gotta
it doesn't
kick
hurt. Then it I didn't hurt it.
Sometimes you gotta kick a geese. Yeah, I just.
You've seen the guy punch the kangaroo?
Yes.
And the kangaroo's just like shocked. So that's what I did to it because like I was walking a lady friend at, uh-huh, Sheridan College.
Right.
And at that point, I'm not even asking a girl out. This is as close I get to a lady friend as when I'm walking in the park.
Right.
This is me practicing. And, mm-hmm, this goose was just following us, hissing. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden it bit. Like at her jeans, mm-hmm, and I was like, "No!" Like, and I just like,
"This is my woman."
Yeah, I lightly kicked it in the face, but I made like a sound, like a knock. And
It was firm.
Yeah, I didn't hit it hard at all. Mm-hmm. The hardest I ever seen a bird get hit was the first time into a golf range. I worked the night shift from 11 to 7 at Walmart, and we got off, and the new guy, who was a kickboxing champ, took me to a golf range because he loves it. Mm-hmm. I went there. I was there for an hour. Yeah. I came back home, woke up my brother, and this is like, I don't know, 8 a.m. on a Saturday. I'm like, let's go. You're going to love it. My brother wakes up. We go, and we are terrible at hitting these balls.
Right.
But we're doing our best, and Omer hits a line drive, and instead of going in the air, it's just going straight, like on the ground. Every now and then it takes a little pat, and then it like the next little bounce is like 40 feet later. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it smokes a seagull. And I mean, it smokes it. This golf ball is going like 200 kilometers an hour, and they're hard. And this thing just goes dunk. And then you just see like one leg come up and then go down. And here's the problem. I'd love to go over there and put it out of its misery, right?
Yeah.
But everybody's hitting their balls like it's a golf range.
You don't want to be hit. Then your leg goes up.
Exactly. You're like, oh no, man. Ooh. Like, I know what happens now. I've seen it happen twice, you know? I just got to wait until this golf park closes. And then we just had to let it die. Mm-hmm. I hope. We just left. Didn't have a good ending.
I used to think I was at my physio and I was talking to him about hunting, and he's like, I have no problem eating meat, but I don't know if I could aim at a deer and shoot it and kill it.
Okay.
I'm like, yeah, fair enough.
Yeah, me too.
And then I was thinking to myself, I probably could kill like a turkey. I felt like I could at that moment. I was just trying to think of like, you know, just trying to put myself in that situation.
Like in your heart, what would you feel like less guilt killing?
Right. I'm like, I'm pretty sure I can kill a turkey.
Yeah.
And then I realized a thing that happened to me in Mauritius. I was driving.
Okay.
And it was a, what do they call it? Lorries?
Yes.
So it's essentially a truck.
Right.
there was a chicken that was crossing the road. Mm-hmm. And chicken didn't look both ways.
Oh no! Why did it cross the road?
I had no idea.
I'm kidding.
And so, he doesn't get run over by the truck,
right?
But the truck runs over it, and then like because of the wind, right? So he starts rolling underneath the truck.
Okay.
So the truck's going, it rolls over the chicken, and the chicken's like ah, and then it starts like whatever buffeting or whatnot. So it gets bounced around underneath this truck.
Oh man.
This is happening in front of me.
Yeah.
Right. And then once when it comes out on the, like when the truck goes and he finally stops flipping.
Right.
And then he's like kind of stunned on the side of the road. So I pull over. Right. And my heart felt so bad for this chicken.
Right.
Right. Because like he was trying to walk a little bit. I'm like, I can't.
Yeah.
Right? And I didn't even have the heart to go out to go help him. Mm-hmm. My uncle had to go out. He's like, don't worry, I got this.
Oh, nice.
So he went outside. Right. He tried to like help the chicken off the road.
Right.
Right. So he kind of like hop limped. Off to the corner. And I feel like he lives around there.
Okay.
So, like, you know, we don't know any chicken any chicken first aid.
Yeah.
But he wasn't going to, like, death wasn't going to be imminent, right, because he was off the road. And then I realized, like, you know, my knees were kind of shaking and whatnot.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm a bitch. I can't even see a chicken, like, get almost killed.
Well, first, like, you didn't see it. That's a very traumatic way to see anything go. Like, even if you were like, you know, I could kill a turkey, you wouldn't kill it with a truck. You know? Like, I saw this one in Mauritius. It'll have a limp, and then we could kill it. Like, you know what I mean? If you had to kill anything with a truck, then we would all be eating vegetables all the time.
Can you imagine? That's the only way you could you kill animals.
That'd be
get
terrible.
Into a Mack truck. All right, just line the cow.
See, this, I had this conversation with a, oh no, I don't want to, but if somebody was telling me, like, they were telling me it seems cruel to butcher it, like cut its neck off. They're like, why don't you shoot it? And it's just dead. Mm-hmm. I was like, good point. It's not halal then, I'm sorry. I have to hunt my animals and then be halal, and then I could shoot it. But like, I don't know, I feel like you could kill a turkey, you could probably kill a deer. Mm-hmm. You could kill a deer, man.
Yeah.
You could probably do it.
Yeah.
It would be heavy, but from what I understand, it'd be very satisfying.
Yeah.
So.
You going to do it this year?
Yeah, I'm going to try, man. I put in for my deer tag. I haven't gotten any news yet. They only give out like a few hundred deer tags. So I got to see if I get it. And if I don't get it, it increases my chances of getting a deer tag next year.
Okay. shouldn't you be at a range, like practicing some shooting?
Shooting animals is easy.
Okay, where do you shoot a deer?
Oh, really good question. So if it's like standing, like it's normally going to be standing broadside.
Right, right.
Very few chances it's looking at you right in the eyes and you're like, boom. But if it's standing broadside... Can you imagine shooting in the head?
Headshot.
No. It's good to shoot an animal in the head because you don't waste any meat that way.
Yeah.
So what you want to do is whenever shooting an animal, try to stay away from the organs, hit a lung. Mm-hmm. Try to stay away from the messy middle organs because mm-hmm. those aren't vital. Mm-hmm. So you threw it on a lung or a heart shot mm-hmm. and it goes down really quickly.
So it's like done within around minutes. The chest area.
Oh, yeah. The rib cage, literally where mm-hmm. the rib cage is.
Oh, okay.
Aim for the heart area. Mm-hmm. You can be off by a certain amount. It's a big zone. Mm-hmm. And it's different from like, depending on what ungulate you have. Mooses are so much harder. Mm-hmm. Every moose hunt I've seen has been like multiple shots.
Yeah.
Bears, well, it seems like everything is good. You could just, as long as not an appendage. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Did you do any research as to how to hunt halali?
I did. I even talked to a Muslim guy with a big beard. I don't know his credentials, but he had a beard. And
this much iman.
Yes, exactly. he said as long as you shoot it and say bismillah, it's all good.
Yeah, that's what I heard as well.
Yeah, it's he was like, I'm pretty, like, he seemed like the guy who wouldn't pass on information unless he was sure.
Yeah.
But I haven't researched it myself. I'm definitely, I know it's, hunting is halal. Like, so, that's tradition. That's
I've done rudimentary, okay, the reason why I did this research mm-hmm. was because I wanted to buy game meat, mm-hmm. but at the time I couldn't find any Muslim places that would carry it. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking to myself, well, it's hunting, so they can't cut it by the neck. So how do you hunt halali? But essentially, yeah, that's what it is. Right before you pull the trigger, you say bismillah, and then you let your bullet fly.
So if you're ever going arrow hunting, bow and arrow, lots of practice. If it's with a gun, you just get in the scope. It's like Halo. As long as you see it in the reticle.
Yeah, but I mean, I still feel like there's got to be some practice, some breathing exercises.
If it's past 200, well, this is a cool thing. Whenever you're shooting a paper, all that goes out the window when you're shooting an animal.
Fair enough.
But if it's like around 200 yards or closer, it's not even dropping a lot.
Yeah.
You know? So after that, you just have to control your nerve.
Recoil. Right. What if you?
You fire off
one shot and it doesn't go down. You pull the bolt and you can fire off another one really quick. I feel like you still need to have some.
No, I don't think you like miss one and then like try to hit a moving animal. And I don't think that thing just stands there like, what was that? That rock exploded. I think they take off.
Yeah.
Animals are very like they recognize humans. They recognize human shapes. Mm-hmm. They recognize human smells. Mm-hmm. Even if like you're baiting them with carrots, mm-hmm. if there's human smell around, they're just like, no, we know the smell. Like mm-hmm. animal turkeys, almost near impossible mm-hmm. to do without like tons of bait and decoy and a friggin' sound you make by rubbing a stick on a piece of wood that sounds like a girl turkey. It's not even easy, man. Even Joe was talking, five hunts he went on, six, mm-hmm. Successful three of them. And this guy's going with the best of the best. Mm-hmm. Like, he's going out with, you know, top shelf people who have shows.
Right.
And he's like, unsuccessful half the time with the best gear and the best people. So, but he got an elk. He's like, all I've been eating is elk meat. Mm-hmm. He put up a friggin' habanero elk steak.
Yeah, I saw. I need to get into this whole cook. Do you know how to cook steak? I don't know how to cook steak, man.
Short ribs are my favorite.
Okay. All right, why don't you explain something for me?
Okay.
If you're just gonna pan fry your steak.
I don't know, man. I don't know about that.
Okay, how do you normally do your steak?
On a grill.
Okay.
On coal or gas.
All right.
And
how thick is a steak?
I like it about an inch.
All right.
And a half. Mm-hmm. And it'll come down to an inch.
Right. Walk me through this process.
So I like to marinate in a lot of I'll take a few seasonings. In garlic sauce. I like to put everything in like garlic.
Right.
It just gives it such a good smell and taste.
Oh, that's great.
So I'll put in some hot pepper and just a lot of black pepper on garlic. This is Texas plus a little bit of Cajun is what I like to do. And I will also, I don't like barbecue sauce per se. but I love hot peppers.
Right.
Habanero, jalapenos, mm-hmm. and I just like to marinate. Mm-hmm. And I've realized that like there's some recipes out there, mm-hmm. but like as long as you like the taste mm-hmm. and you want your steak to have like your meat to have that kind of like hint of those things, mm-hmm. you'll enjoy it.
Right?
You can go with like something you like online. But you're like, I like this flavor, you can't mess it up.
Okay, so this is a dry rub that you're, yes. that you're explaining.
Yeah,
okay.
But I like a little bit of garlic paste.
Okay.
And then I just throw it on a grill, and I like to do it slow. I like to leave it like really one side. Mm-hmm. It's not a thick steak, it'll cook on both sides. I'll flip it over, but it's, you just do it by eye, and you do it by like whenever you feel like is right. It's actually cooking on fire, especially meat. Mm-hmm. It's very forgiving, mm-hmm. right? All you want to be careful about is like make sure that the juices don't run out. Like, don't do it too much where it's not juicy. Yeah. So like fish, I have hard time doing fish. Like it's just tough. Chicken is easy. Far and I have partridges at home. Like they're chickens that are this big. Mm-hmm. So we're actually gonna have a cook off next Wednesday mm-hmm. where we both like bake our own partridge. Mm-hmm. And I'm like looking up, I credit all my like instincts in terms of how I enjoy food from Anthony Bourdain. Uh-huh. I watched so much Anthony Bourdain and read so much Anthony Bourdain. Yeah. At this point, like I have seen, people don't realize there's Parts Unknown and whatever the stopover, but there's like, he has so many shows
yeah.
and a lot of them never even made it onto air, but now Netflix is buying them. There's two of them that I've never seen mm-hmm. and there's like four new episodes.
Right.
And you realize there's really no wrong way to do it. It's just like some rules you have to follow, but then it just comes down to like your own taste buds.
What you like tasting. Yeah.
Oh man. It's so satisfying mm-hmm. to like go down to like, you know, Minna Grocers mm-hmm. and be like, yeah, can I have that piece of steak? And sometimes it'll be like, you want me to like, no, I'll cut it. I like doing that all. I like to like take a big piece of meat mm-hmm. and like, I'm gonna eat this today. I'm gonna eat this tomorrow. And Friday I'll have this small one, but then on Saturday I'm gonna have this big one. And I'll like just different marinades and stuff like that. And just throw it on a coal grill. I got a tiny Walmart coal grill. Mm-hmm. that I'm not using enough because of the winter right now. But like, oh, it's every now and then, even in the winter, I'm like, let's do it. Like,
yeah, whatever. I'm thinking of picking up a grill too.
Gas grills are pretty good too.
I think I might do that for this season.
You know what short ribs are?
No.
The meat in between your ribs, like mm-hmm. you do this.
Yeah.
This is your rib, this is a rib, the meat in between. Mm-hmm. They can cut that out. Mm-hmm. And it's so good to just some Szechuan sauce, mm-hmm. a little bit of soy sauce, garlic sauce, and some just hot peppers mm-hmm. and just roll it around in there. And you probably have to cook like 8 of these strips mm-hmm. and it cooks so quickly because they're pretty thin. They're delicious. And not because ribs, it's not fat, right?
Yeah,
it's a lot of just like lean meat. So it cooks really quick. Mm-hmm. It's so good. My mouth is watering right now. It's so good.
I didn't know you were such a grill aficionado.
My parents bought one. Uh-huh. We all went on a cottage trip this past summer. Yeah. Farah was awesome enough to go to Paramount Grocers. Mm-hmm. And they have the best, they're pricey, best meat though. Okay. And we got some short ribs and she marinated it just off of instincts. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh.
genetic instincts?
Yeah, I was like, oh, where'd you get this recipe? She's like, oh, no, this is just like, this. I feel like this is gonna taste good.
Okay.
We had this at the cottage. My parents next week bought a grill. We've never had a gas grill in our lives, but based on the taste we got there, uh-huh. or like, oh, we can get a gas grill. Because we had a coal one, but who's going to go warm up coal for half an hour, man? Not a friggin' Neanderthal.
That's, I think that's unique to when you are not working anymore. Mm.
What do you mean?
Yeah, when you, like, if you retire, or if you can retire a little earlier or whatnot, then you can start learning, like, the nuances of, like fire cooking.
Oh, I love making a fire. I love getting the coals ready. Mm-hmm. It's just, like, such a slow process. I'm like, I just want to eat. I don't want to cook for... And like an hour and then eat for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Can I cook for, 20 minutes?
When I was in Mauritius and we did like this road trip, just mm-hmm. me and all the guy cousins rented a truck. So we went around half of the entire island.
Yeah.
And where we ended up mm-hmm. is where all of our family met us there as well. And then we're going to do a barbecue.
Yeah.
So we left like early morning and just kept driving the circumference
of
the island, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so we just made it so that the end point would be where the entire family could meet us there and mm-hmm. we would do a barbecue. So it was an epic day.
That's awesome.
For us.
Family barbecue.
And the barbecue, they had two barbecues and it was coal. Mm. And that took a while just to set up.
Yeah.
By that time, we got there, we were starving.
You probably had a fire guy. One uncle was like, I can do this.
Yeah, he was a fire guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, give me that carton. Yeah. That carton, that thing. And
but it takes just, so long. Yeah, this thing. Oh, my God.
Just what is it called? Venting?
Yeah. So this waving? Is what I realized. If you have a metal pipe and you put the pipe first and then you put the coal in a pyramid on top of it and then you light this pyramid and as it's lighting up, when you blow in, the fire goes nuts and the coal starts burning from the inside out.
I see.
That's the best way to do it. That's the fastest way to do it.
Okay. Does the pipe not get hot?
It's a long pipe.
Okay.
Let's say if it's this long.
Yeah.
It's good enough.
Really?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Totally. So like there's another way to do it if you're ever in the woods.
Uh-huh.
I don't know why. Like, if you're ever in the woods.
This is the one lesson that I'm going to take. I'm in the woods. There's raccoons everywhere.
No. There's a lot of good ways to like make fires and stuff. But we could do it, man. We should. This is what we should do. Mm. First, I got to get a hunting tag. Mm-hmm. And then we should cook a meal like properly over some like either using wood or coal. And then we should do a blog about it. And we should also do that genetic test and stuff.
Yeah. We were talking about the genetic test. I'm not giving up my blood.
National Geographic doesn't sell it. Okay. They're the only ones. I don't know if they're the only ones. I know 23andMe sells it to like some people.
Yeah.
But I don't have a problem with that.
We already spoke about this.
I know.
Can't have my DNA out there.
Okay.
Dude, it's so easy. They'd be like, yeah, Yasin killed that person. How do we know? Why we got drops of blood here.
Why do they want you?
I don't know.
No, make it up then. I can't imagine why, like in your head, what's the scenario? Get the photographer. Like, no, nobody cares.
Dude, I've watched many documentaries of people wrongfully accused of stuff.
You mean documentaries or movies?
Documentaries. Have you seen, you were on Netflix for a little bit.
Let's I want talk you to say bit. Like, have you seen Born Identity?
Alex Knox, Elizabeth Knox. Hold on, I gotta get this because like she was
that murder trial thing.
No, that's making a, that's a.
I can't stand those. All those.
You didn't like Making a Murder?
I don't like any of those murder shows.
Why?
I don't know,
dude. It wasn't a show. It's a nine part documentary.
Is it
about
only
this.
Nine?
Yeah,
oh, that's not bad. Maybe I should check it out. I didn't watch that Adnan guy. Adnan whatever. Serial? I didn't listen to that.
You didn't listen to it?
No.
Dude.
Everybody I know listened
to
it.
No, you don't understand, though. Because not... Okay. All right. Hold on. One thing at a time. Amanda Knox.
Yeah.
That's her. Yeah. Amanda Knox spent almost 4 years in an Italian prison following a conviction in 2007 of murder of Meredith Kircher. But there was no... Like, she...
How did they?
There wasn't enough. There was nowhere enough evidence to convict her. She was wrongfully convicted.
So what like DNA service did she use? Like who sold her out, Yasin? I don't see the connection.
You're right. There is no connection.
Right.
All I'm saying is that she wasn't even there.
Let's
she
do
was
it,
in
man. Let's do a 23andMe. You're probably like.
All right. Fair enough. We'll do it.
Part something.
All right. Let's do it.
What would be the most shocking thing?
About me?
Yeah. What if you were like. Chinese or some shit.
Okay, wait, hold on.
Just not expect any of my like forefathers to be like in China.
There might be no reason.
We're very close.
Yeah, exactly. There might be a very good chance that with this part
happen.
Chinese.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah. Why wouldn't it?
Geographically means.
No, you know what? That's what it like. I'm not good at math. I'm good at driving. I'm kidding. no, I'm kidding. Asian guys are great at driving. Asian girls too. It's an age thing. I think it's like you get to an uncle. If you drove in Pakistan or if you drove in China, you suck at driving here. You know, you're like commando. You're just like.
I can't say that.
No.
Okay. Hold on. Just put a pin in this driving thing for a second. I just want to circle back just real quick. Adnan Syed.
Yeah.
And you listen to podcasts like more than me even.
Yeah.
And you haven't listened to probably one of the most successful podcast series ever.
I think it's possibly the most.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Dude, not only, just because it's an absolutely like celebrated podcast.
Yeah.
Okay.
It makes it intimidating.
Quiet you. Then there is the
it's
fact
listening
that,
time for Syed. Not talking.
NPR.
Yeah.
Just as an audiophile of myself, right. The quality of this podcast.
Man,
friend.
That's just you.
Okay,
that's
fair
just
enough,
you.
Fair enough. We'll move on. We'll move on. Another one. Adnan Syed is Muslim.
I understand. It has my name, for God's sake, Yasin.
Right. But the thing is that he was doing like stuff that we would have done. I don't know. I can't speak for you, but like,
wasn't he going out with a white girl?
Yeah, you know. And but they had to keep it secret. But they had to keep it secret, or they wanted to go to prom together. There's like there's small nuances of like our lives there. Like or but he was also involved in the masjid. You know, he was like leading prayers or something. I don't know what. Right. But like, it's like this this intersection of culture, religion.
You're saying
like,
I can relate to this guy?
There's going to be aspects of his story that you definitely will be able to relate to.
That's
to the point where you might be thinking to yourself, if I was in the wrong place at the wrong time,
right,
I might be in jail.
Mm. Well, I know that. I grew up in Houston.
Okay.
There's drive-bys and shit.
Right.
Like, people are all the time at the wrong place at the wrong, because cops come and they don't care. They're taking somebody.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Listen, you have to listen to it. You don't have to listen to season 2. Season 2 is completely different for Bo Bergdahl, the guy who, that was interesting too, though. I enjoyed it. Bo Bergdahl was a guy who felt like the U.S. military wasn't doing what they were supposed to do, something along these lines.
Okay.
And so he wanted to create a thing that would gain the attention of the upper military personnel.
Wolfman soldier.
So what he decided to do was he decided to just walk off reservation, called like went AWOL. Mm-hmm. He's just missing. And what he was going to do is that he was going to walk from one base to another base. And by the time he got there, there would be such a crazy thing about like them missing a soldier that he would be able to force his way to be able to like complain to upper like the upper chain. But what happens is that on his way there, he gets kidnapped by the Taliban.
Sorry.
And that's what most people thought about him. And he was in captivity for like years.
Am I having the wrong reaction? Think this is funny?
No.
Not that it's funny that he wasn't, you know, caught for years.
Yeah.
Just
no,
like,
it's funny.
You shouldn't walk from. That's what happens.
Yeah, you're in Afghanistan or Iraq or wherever it is that you were.
If the Taliban is around, you don't walk from places to place.
When you're a U.S. military soldier.
Doesn't make sense.
Anyway, that's all to say. All you don't have to listen to season 2. Just listen to season 1. It's freaking amazing, dude.
I'll do it. You know how many podcasts I listen to, man?
I know.
I know how many podcasts you listen to. I don't listen. Like, I got too many. And I like them. I like them all. I like Your Mom's House. I like Ari. I like Bill Burr. I like Joe.
I like Bill Burr.
And Joe's like kicked it up a notch where he's like releasing 2 to 3 podcasts a week now because he's doing Let's UFC. And it's great. He has an ex-football player on.
Yeah.
Because his ex-football player said that he could kill a wolf with his bare hands.
Yeah.
He's like, they don't have thumbs.
Yeah. He got called out.
Yeah. And Joe had him on. I haven't heard it yet, but Joe's going to be like, you can't kill a wolf. I can't wait.
I'm on the Neil deGrasse Tyson one.
It's okay.
It's not bad. I liked
it.
I liked
it.
I like
it. All right.
There was one thing. Actually, yeah, there was one takeaway that I think might be worthwhile sharing right now.
Cool.
The whole idea of you can't measure something because when you measure something, the act of you measuring it affects the thing that you're measuring. Mm. I forgot specifically what this whole scenario is called. You never heard of this?
No, I need to hear an example. I hope you're good at explaining
so,
this.
You know what? I'm going to take a minute. Why don't you talk about something real quick? I just need to figure out this
one.
All
right, sure. I could talk about something. Yeah. So Netflix added this movie, Independence Day 2.
Holy shit, so bad.
So 2 days ago, so I was like, oh, let's watch this. We sat down and watched this piece of turd from start to finish. At first, I'm like, you know what? It's stupid, but it's, you know, it's moving along. Mm-hmm. And then I realized this, whoever was making this movie was tripping on acid, where the storytelling is so disjointed and it's slow and then it's fast and it's stupid. And the screenplay, the dialogue is like, who's idiot? I don't have the words to know how much, like, the graphics are great. Somebody spent $200 million on a piece of shit.
You watched it till the end, though, right?
I watched it till the end, yeah.
So did I.
Of course. What do you want me to do? And I regretted it.
Mm-hmm.
I did not have any redeeming qualities.
I kind of regretted it, too. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a big alien. I've seen this movie. It's called Aliens. It's better.
Yeah, it's so much better. Okay, here we go. The observer effects in physics is termed to the observer effects refers to changes that the act of observation will make on the phenomenon being observed. This is often the result of instruments that by necessity alters the state of what they measure in some manner.
What's an example of that?
So a lot of people were saying that because you're measuring something, that right. your very consciousness of you saying that you, or thinking that you're going to measure something affects what's being measured. Okay. But that's not true. Essentially what it is, let's say like, okay.
Is there like anything I can...
Hold on, here we go.
Yeah.
The room is dark and I want to see where you are. So I put on a light and I look at you like, there you are. You turn off the light. Then let's imagine if there's a smaller version of you and I need to find you. So I turn on the light, I look around, I'm like, oh, there you are, right? Now imagine you were like a particle.
Right,
or
a grain of
sand. Or something, like an atom. When you turn on the light
to
measure where this person is,
right,
or thing, photons of light will bounce off of you and actually, because it needs to bounce off of you to go into my eyes, right?
Right.
Every time I put light on, the light is shining on you and bounces off of you and then it enters my eyes. That's right. How I know where you are, right?
Mm.
Where if you get to such a small thing that the light that bounces off of you makes you move a bit.
Nice.
So it bounces off of you, it goes into my eyes, but it moves as a result of the light bouncing off of you.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
Cool.
That was the explanation.
I learned something today.
That I thought it was pretty cool.
Nice.
There's a podcast you can't listen to when you're working.
No, you're right.
Cannot do it.
No, you're not. Absolutely not. Joe does. That's the special thing about Joe is he'll have actual smart people on, like Rhonda Patrick or Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Yeah.
And then I'll have like other people are just comics. Like the Tom Papa one I'm listening to right now.
They're so pleasant.
It's just so pleasant. And Tom's such a charming guy too. Yeah. And he has like all these life experiences and stuff. And they don't even know each other before the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really cool. It's like, some good conversationalists.
Yeah, it's great. Speaking about very cool people.
Mm-hmm.
Eric is going to be on the podcast next week.
Eric Voss. What are we going to talk about?
We're going to be talking about Logan.
Logan!
And you watched it. We watched it already, right?
Yeah, man.
We watched it already. Okay.
It's all I've been thinking about.
It's so good.
I was talking about our work today.
Right. But we're going to respect the Eric. He was supposed to be on this podcast, but...
His eye's twitching.
Apparently. So he's told that he needs to take a break.
Yeah, man.
I'm thinking to myself, podcasts are relaxing.
No, you know what? Bring your A game. Put that twitchy eye down and then come see me so we can talk some Logan.
Yeah, definitely looking forward to that for next week. Okay, people, that is the end of the podcast. We'll be back in a week. We love you all. Take care of yourselves.